This is a picture of the first human organ transplant. The transplant was done by doctors Joseph Murray and John Merrill at Brigham and Women's Hospital in Boston. The recipient was Richard Herrick, a 23-year-old man with severe kidney disease. The donor was Herrick's 23-year-old identical twin Ronald Herrick. Prior to this, organ transplant had very low success rates because of immune rejection. Our immune cells would recognize the difference between the host and recipient cells, and after transplantation, if the immune cells discovered the foreign cells, they would attack the transplanted organs. However, in twins, the cells have a very similar genetic profile, and the probability of immune rejection would be pretty low. Currently, we have different methods to reduce the risk of immune rejection, such as HLA typing and immunosuppressant drugs. But still, acute rejection is a common complication in the first year after a transplant, which affects 1 in 3 people. This is a ghost heart that would help patients with immune rejection. We can also find different ghost organs such as livers and kidneys. The name ghost comes from its distinct color difference from a real organ, as it appears white in color. The defining feature of these organs is the lack of cells, which distinguishes them from natural organs, and we can make them in the lab. Let me explain. If you look at a normal tissue or organ in our body, they're made of two different parts, different cells and the extracellular matrix. If we consider an organ as a house, the cells would be the bricks and the ECM would be the foundation and framework of the house. However, the genetic material of everybody's organs is in the nuclei of the cells. So if somehow we remove the cells from the ECM, the risk of immune rejection would decrease. There are different ways to do this. One way is to use physical methods, like applying mechanical forces to the tissue to break apart the cells and release the ECM. Another option is to use chemical methods, like detergent or acids, to dissolve the cells and leave behind the ECM. And if you want to get really fancy, you could use enzymes like DNAs and RNAs to break down the donor genetic materials. But each of these methods have its own strengths and weaknesses. Physical methods can be harsh and might damage the ECM, while chemical methods can leave behind unwanted contaminants. Enzymes are more specific and can be gentler, but they can also be expensive and time-consuming. So what do scientists do? Well, they often use a combination of these methods to get the best of both worlds. They would use a bit of mechanical forces to break apart the tissue, followed by a chemical treatment to dissolve the cells and leave behind the ECM, and then finishing up with some enzyme to clean up the ECM and remove any leftover contaminants. But what's the point of having tissues and organs ECM without cells? The idea is to use recipient stem cells for reseeding these decellularized organs, which is called recellularization. But why do we use ECM for culturing stem cells? The ECM is primarily made of proteins, such as collagen, which is the most abundant protein in the ECM. There are more than 20 different types of collagen with different structures and properties. However, there are other molecules such as elastin, fibronectin, laminin, glycosaminoglycans or GAGs, which are long, unbranched polysaccharide chains. The other one is proteoglycan, which contains protein cores with glycosaminoglycan side chain. So the structure of ECM is really complex, and every tissue has its own specific ECM structures, and they contain a lot of information for stem cells. The composition and organization of the extracellular matrix is established during tissue development and maturation. The matrix is dynamically regulated and remodeled as the tissue develops, with different proteins being deposited and aligned in a specific spatial pattern. This developmental history is then stored within the mature extracellular matrix in the form of which proteins are present, how they are arranged, and which signaling molecules are embedded. When cells interact with this mature extracellular matrix, they can effectively read its biochemical structures and composition, which reflects the developmental origins and lineage of that tissue. Cells can interpret this developmental memory encoded in the matrix as a cue to guide their own differentiation, function, and behavior in a manner appropriate for that specific tissue type. The extracellular matrix essentially contains an imprint of the developmental history of the tissue, which continues to influence cell phenotype and tissue homeostasis even in the mature state. By using the information in the ECM, we can engineer specific tissues and organs for regenerative purposes. Using decellularized tissue is common in practice, but complex organs such as the kidney or heart are more challenging, and we still have a long way from being able to re-engineer them in that way.